Good evening tonight from Chapel Baptist Church. This is Pastor Joe. I know all of you are at home right now, as am I, and I am the only person in church right now, which is kind of an odd feeling. But what we're going to do is what I would like to do for you is so that you can eat spiritually while you're there at your house and in your homes waiting for this coronavirus thing to be over with. So I'm just going to tell you what we're planning on tonight. We're going to plan on three songs. And I would like you to sing with me as we go through these songs, and it'll be a blessing for you where you find yourself.
Thank you.
Songs of the faith, aren't they? Even if we mess up on them. Turn with me in your Bibles now. Verse number 1, chapter 11, 1 Samuel. Then Nahash the Ammonite came up and encamped against Jabesh-Gilead, and all the men of Jabesh said unto Nahash, make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee. And Nahash the Ammonite answered them, on this condition will I make a covenant with you, that I may thrust out all your right eyes and lay it for a reproach upon all Israel. And elders of Jabesh said unto him, give us 7 days respite, that we may send messengers unto all the coasts of Israel, and then if there be no man to save us, we will come out to thee. Then came the messengers to Gibeah of Saul, and told the tidings in the ears of the people. And all the people lifted up their voices and wept. And behold, Saul came after the herd out of the field, and Saul said, what aileth the people that they weep? And they told him the tidings of the men of Jabesh. And the Spirit of God came upon Saul when he heard those tidings, and his anger was kindled greatly. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this time together. And Father, may you use this in our lives today. Help us to seek you out, knowing how crazy this time is. We ask you for comfort. We ask you for empowerment, for the things that we need the most. Give us your peace from on high, and help us to know you better through this time. Though apart, yet all together. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's interesting to see through our study of We Three Kings, we're studying the life of Saul at this point in time. And Saul, interesting enough, has issues, not of sinful proportions, as will be later, but rather, the fact is that he is not seen to be a good leader. We talked about this last week, and we showed We went through all the different aspects of when Saul went to Samuel, and he was looking for his father's donkeys. Now, he had not the initiative in order to think of this himself. Is actually his servant that said, we could do this. We could go to the man of God and see what he will say for us. Saul wanted to quit, but the servant said, no, there is a viable option. Let's ask the man of God. Interesting, Saul was not like his servant. He wasn't even prepared to pay. He said, well, what do we have to give him? And the servant said, well, I have some money. The servant was more well prepared than was Saul himself. And so interesting, he is not fit to be a good leader. The time that we're studying is that the end of the Judges era, and actually the beginning of the kings, and that Saul will be crowned king in this passage, in the passage before, in chapter number 10. So, we have to ask ourselves the question, is Saul the one that was meant to be? And the answer is, well, David ultimately is the king that God had set apart for himself to be the king of Israel. But at this point in time, the people wanted to have a different ruler. The people wanted a different show. The people wanted someone just like the rest of the nations. They wanted someone that could lead them into battle, that could go against the people that invaded their lands. So they wanted a king. We studied this the first week, that very fact that he would not be the answer that they really wanted. He's going to be the answer that they asked for. And so much more, we need to be careful of what we ask for. Because if we don't want God's best, and we will settle for anything else, the things that we really, really, really want, sometimes God gives it to us, though in spite of what he wanted us to have. Saul is the one that the people will naturally assume to be king. As we saw last week, he is tall, something I am not. The joke is that some people not be able to see me when I'm behind the pulpit because I am kind of a short stature. But it's okay. Everybody loves a short preacher. Short in length of time that we preach. So Saul is the guy that Samuel said, the Lord has chosen you to be the king. And Samuel gave him signs after signs after sign. The very fact that he is going to be the king is there. But unfortunately, he's not of good courage that he would naturally say that to anybody that asked him. So he went from one sign to another sign to another sign, as we saw last week. And then he went to his uncle, and his uncle said, Saul, you went to Samuel. And Saul would say, yeah, I saw the prophet. And what did he tell you? Well, just simple fact that dad's donkeys were found. And he would not talk about the very fact that he is going to be the king. We saw that he is right now a miserable leader, one that could not lead anybody anywhere. And so that's where we're going to pick it up right now in chapter 10. We read chapter 11. Let's look at chapter 10 just to recap. In verse number 17 of chapter number 10 of 1 Samuel, talks to them about is the very fact that they are rebellious against God. Verse 15, Saul's uncle, verse 17, and Samuel called the people together unto the Lord and to Mizpah, and said unto the children of Israel, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I brought up Israel out of Egypt, and delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, out of the hand of all kingdoms, and of them that oppressed you. And ye have this day rejected your God, who himself saved you out of all your adversities and your tribulations, and ye have said unto him, Nay, but set a king over us. Now therefore present yourselves before the Lord by your tribes and by your thousands. See, here Saul is not in the mix right now. Here is just Samuel reminding the people of the very reality of their rejection of God. You remember back when in the book of Exodus, that where did we find the nation of Israel? We found the nation of Israel in bondage. There was a king that knew not Joseph, and so because of that, the Israelites became enslaved, lest they revolted against them, and they treated him harshly. The Egyptians got into power, and now the Pharaoh there, it's established that the economy is based upon these slaves working, and just the very fact that they were under much affliction. Then we see Moses come on the scene. Moses, who somehow, some way, knew he was a Hebrew, and so decided to show forth himself to be the savior of the people that will bring them out of Egypt. I'm not quite sure what he was thinking at this point in time. He was possibly a captain of the host of Pharaoh, according to Josephus, and might have had many great military conquests, possibly. But the very fact that he decided to show, not in God's timing, but rather in haste, he was then taken out for 40 years in the wilderness, watching nothing but dumb animals, sheep. Every day he would get up. Oh, there's the sheep. Every day he would go throughout the day. Oh, got to get the sheep over here to better land. Oh, we got to get that wandering sheep back here. Oh, these sheep, they're kind of stubborn right now, so I'm going to have to take measures against them in order for them to obey. Then God shows up, and then he goes back to Egypt, and he becomes the leader that God wants him to be. And through Moses, so many signs and wonders were given to the Israelites and the Egyptians, and Moses was able to, by God's hand, deliver his own people out of bondage. What an amazing story. But yeah, even more so, the Egyptians went after him. If they did not learn their lesson, hey, your crops are dead, your animals are gone, your firstborn are now dead as well, and you're going to go after these people? I would just say, let them alone. Just leave them alone, okay? But no, they went after him. They had a hard heart. They went after him. God did an amazing miracle in parting the Red Sea, and they walked on dry ground on all the way to the other side. The Egyptians were not as blessed, and they were overcome with great waterfall. Amazing. God delivering his people. And then not only delivering them, but also taking care of them in the wilderness for 40 years. You think about it. They needed water. They got fresh water out of a rock. They wanted food. They got manna. Literally what it means is, what is it? What is it? What is it? It's manna. What is it? Well, it tastes pretty good. And it comes every morning, except for on the Sabbath day. And so God miraculously provides for the people of Israel. Over and abundantly, God did miraculous things in order to show Israel how great he is. And yet, they would murmur, they would complain. They would get to the threshold of the promised land, and then try to go in, and 10 says we can't do it because there are giants in their land. 2 say yes, we can, because God is more able. They are but bread for us. And the people cited after the 10 instead of the 2. It's unfortunate. Human nature always rebels against God. And once again, now they're into the land. They saw all the miraculous things that happened during the time of Joshua. That the walls of Jericho, this mighty fortress, came down. That the sun stood still in the sky. Amazing things happened during Joshua's time, and they secured the land for themselves. They got houses that they never built. God told them they would. They received vineyards that they never planted. God told them that they are going to receive it. They got olive yards and various other fields of whatnot, of crops and various things, and they were plentiful. It was a land flowing with milk and honey. But yet, during the time of the judges, they all did what was right in their own eyes. And so what happened was the very fact that they rejected God again by asking for a king, not of his own choosing. It's not God's choice, but rather the people wanted to be like the rest of the nations. And therefore, God gave them exactly what they asked for. And they're going to give him Saul. From the point of time that we met him, he doesn't strike us as a great leader. And so we're going to also see here, not just that the people of Israel have rejected God's best and decided to be like everybody else, but secondly, also that Saul is a not so great of a leader. Look with me at verse number 19. Verse number 20. And when Samuel had caused all the tribes of Israel to come near, the tribe of Benjamin was taken. When he had caused the tribe of Benjamin to come near by their families, the family of Matri was taken, and Saul was taken, the son of Kish was taken. And when they sought him, notice this, he could not be found. Where was he? Well, Saul, you think this would be a big deal to go to this event? You think, okay, Israel, guess what? Samuel's going to pick the king that you have asked for. Won't this be exciting? It'd be like beginning of America, after the war for independence was won. Now is the time where we said, okay, who is going to be the president? After much deciding, Washington was picked, and he was picked unanimously. And I could just imagine what the amazing feeling of the entire colonies was at that point in time when the first president came into the office of the presidency. I can imagine a great festival happened. I can imagine a great parade happened. I'm not sure if back then was similar to what we have today, but you think something just tremendous happened. We got the first president of the United States. We're no longer under King George. Something similar is here in the nation of Israel. Saul, he's going to be the next king. But he's nowhere to be found. Why? Because, well, I think he's a little nervous, maybe. He's a little scared. Might be a little afraid. So notice with me where they found him. Verse 22. Therefore they inquired of the Lord further if the man should not come hither. And the Lord answered, behold, he hath hid himself among the stuff. And they ran and fetched him thence, and he stood among the people. He was higher than any of the people from his shoulders and upward. So when he was found among the stuff. It's not very specific. He was hiding. You remember the game hide and go seek? I'm sure your children or your grandchildren have played it. One person is it. Everybody else hides. And then you just wait to see who is the last one picked. It's a fun game, as long as everybody picks. I remember hearing about one time this father, now this is probably not, hopefully not a true story. This father decided to play hide and go seek with his son. And he said, okay, I'm going to be it, so you go ahead and hide. And so the son goes, okay. And then he goes and hides. Well, the father then takes time to go out into the living room and starts watching TV without any intent to actually find his son. Now that's a terrible idea for a father to not play with his son, but to watch television instead. But yeah, here's Saul playing a little hide and go seek. And guess what? He's actually it, and everybody else is trying to find him. Oh, Saul, Saul. He is not the brave one that a leader needs to be. He is not the one that will take charge right now. He is a little timid. But yet, his stature is high. You think he is the tallest man in the room. He's tall. I don't know how tall he was. If it be true about their height at that point in time, I've heard that the normal size of them were about 5'7" or so. So he might have been 6 foot tall. 6 foot two, 6 foot five. I know a 6 foot five person. And actually, I know a lot of tall people. And they're always good to look up to for me. So with Saul, he is the tallest man in the room. And he says, this is the one. This is going to be the king. And so what happened next is that everybody was very excited about this. It said, verse 24, and Samuel said to all the people, see ye him whom the Lord hath chosen, that there is none like him among all the people. And all the people shouted and said, God save the king. Everybody's so excited that this is the next king. He is the king of Israel. And they're all cheering. They're very excited at this point in time. Except for some people didn't. Verse 25, and then Samuel told the people the manner of the kingdom and wrote it in a book and laid it up before the Lord. And Samuel sent all the people away, every man to his house. And Saul also went home to Gibeah. And there went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched. So Saul was cheered on by all the people. There's a group of men that said, okay, we're going to be with you, Saul. Where you go, we're going to go with you. And where did Saul go? He went back to Gibeah, back to be a farmer for his dad. You're the king of Israel. What's going to happen? You're the king. Why are you going back to be a farmer? And here's when verse 27, somebody didn't quite like Saul as king. But the children of Belial said, how shall this man save us? And they despised him and brought him no presents, but he held his peace. At this point in time, he is the king of Israel. He hears people grumbling against him, despising him. As a king, he has the right to be the judge, jury, and executioner. The three branches of our government is seen all in the kingship. That's why we have three different and equal branches. The executive branch are the ones that execute the laws. The legislative branch makes the laws. The judicial branch interprets the law. So all these different things has to come together, and the king is the one that has all the authority and the right to do whatever pleased him at that point in time. Now, why did Saul not react? Good question. I don't know. Maybe he's just not sure what to do. And many times, when I was beginning to be a lead at South Lake Hospital, I didn't know what to do a lot. So I walked around and I looked at different things. I looked at different people and what they were doing. And I was trying to just act the part at this point in time. Until one of them noticed me walking around. And he smiled at me. And he said in a very thick Haitian accent, "You have no idea what you're doing, do you?" No, I don't. And so possibly Saul, the king of Israel, has no idea what he should be doing right now. So he goes back to Gibeah, possibly pretending nothing ever happened. So here we saw that nothing's changed with Saul from last time to this time. And you think, well, he's not the leader that he needs to be. Well, God's going to change that in chapter 11. Chapter 11 is amazing because there arises a need for Saul to act. This action will now specifically change him into the person that God wants him to be. Notice with me the threat. First of all, the threat. Look with me in verse number 11, chapter 11, verse number 1. Then Nahash the Ammonite came up and encamped against Jabesh-Gilead. And all the men of Jabesh said unto Nahash, "Make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee." Okay, first of all, we have a problem on the border. Jabesh-Gilead was on the border between Israel and the Ammonites, or the children of Ammon. Children of Ammon, they're related all the way back to Lot. So they are somewhat distant cousins, but yet the Ammonites would come into the land to try to take the different cities that are on the border to try to get more and more land back from what Israel has already taken. So, with all that said, Nahash invades the land. The men of Jabesh-Gilead, they kind of give up and say, "Okay, we'll make a covenant with you. Just make peace with us. We don't want any trouble. We just want peace." So often peace comes at a great price when you just give up to the enemy. So what happens is the threat, Nahash, gives an agreement that no one could agree to. Verse number 2. And Nahash the Ammonite answered them, "On this condition will I make a covenant with you, that I may thrust out all your right eyes and lay it for a reproach upon all Israel." The right eyes. Boy, that is kind of a weird thing to say. Why don't you pluck out both eyes? Well, here's the thing about it. The right eye specifically was for war. The very fact that they had certain shields that they would cover themselves with and be able to cover just about everything of importance of their body, but yet the right eye was able to see so they could progress in the battle. So what he's saying is, "I will make you defenseless so you will never rise up against me ever again." And so they will be one-eyed people. Well, no one is going to say yes to this unless they're absolutely terrified. Absolutely. There's no other condition. There's no one that could save them. There's no one around. Here's what they say, verse number 3. And the elders of Jabesh said unto him, "Give us 7 days respite. That we may send messengers unto all the coast of Israel. And then if there be no man to save us, we will come out to thee." Interesting that the men of Jabesh-Gilead didn't say, "Well, we have a king and we're going to get him and he's going to come and save us." No, that's not what they said. they said, we're going to find out if there's somebody that can save us, but if not, we'll do what you say. We'll come out. No high hopes there of Saul coming to rescue them. If somebody comes, there's no hope. So notice with me what happens. And verse number 4, then came the messengers to Gibeah of Saul and told the tidings in the ears of the people, and all the people lifted up their voices and wept. And behold, Saul came after the herd out of the field. So he was done with his day of working the field with the oxen, and he is done for the day. He comes back to the city, and the messengers are there talking to the people, saying that Jabesh-Gilead is going under siege with the Ammonites, and this is their condition. What will happen with them? I'm sure they came to Gibeah because they knew Saul was there. He is the king of Israel. Now, if he's anything like he was back in chapter number 10, he's not real one to go out to war. Rather, the servant that he has is better able and capable to figuring out solutions. His father was a warrior, and he himself was just tall. And then he had no faith like that of Samuel, so he had problems. But yet, they come to him and say the news. And here, God does something amazing. He empowers Saul to be who he needs to be at that very moment in time that an answer, a Savior needs to come and defeat the enemy of God so that the people could have rest. So the people can be safe. And so notice with me what happens with Saul. Notice with me verse number 5 again. And Saul said in the middle of the verse, what aileth the people that they weep? And they told him the tidings of the men of Jabesh. And the Spirit of God came upon Saul when he heard those tidings, and his anger was kindled greatly. What it was for back in those days, the Spirit of God would come upon a man in order to accomplish a task at a certain point in time. You saw that over and over again in the book of Judges. You have a judge, after the people had gone astray from God, they went into captivity in a way. They had invading people come into the land and conquer the land. And they cried out to God because of the oppression of the people. And he would send a deliverer, a judge. And it would say at various points in time that the Spirit of God came upon that judge to do something amazing. You think of Samson and his immense strength. You think of Gideon, just like Saul, very, very cowardly. But yet, when the Spirit of God came upon him, he became a man of great courage. Over in abundance, the Spirit of God would come upon somebody, and they would do something amazing by the power of God. And so what we see here is the very notion that when God has called us to do something or to be something, God is able and enables us to be and to do of his good pleasure and will, as long as we submit and walk with him. Saul becomes the man he needs to be. The Spirit of God came upon him. God used his anger to go against the people of the children of Ammon. And notice with me, Saul brings together the group of men that will become his army in a very interesting and peculiar way. Notice with me, verse number 7, and he took an yoke of oxen and hewed them in pieces and sent them throughout all the coast of Israel by the hands of of messengers, saying, whosoever cometh not forth after Saul and after Samuel, so shall it be done unto his oxen. And the fear of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out with one consent. And he numbered them in Bezek, the children of Israel were 300,000 and the men of Judah 30,000. So he encouraged the people greatly. He took some oxen that he had and he cut them up into 12 different segments and he would send it abroad. And he said, whoever doesn't come, your oxen shall be like this. Okay, well, you mean business, Mr. King. We're going to come. And 330,000 soldiers come to his aid. You think about different kings and their encouraged. I think of Nebuchadnezzar. He encouraged the wise men to come forward and give him the dream that he had and the interpretation thereof, or else they would die. He's a good encourager. Also, he would encourage his people to worship his golden image, and three men said no. He encouraged them, otherwise they're going to be thrown into a burning, fiery furnace. And he says, who is the God that can deliver you out of my... He tries to encourage quite drastically. So Saul, very similar to that, he encourages his people to come, and they, but with a fear of God, they come. And they come ready for war. Then look at with me. Amazing how Saul changes all of a sudden. Verse number 9, and they said unto the messengers that came, thus shall ye say unto the men of Jabesh Gilead, tomorrow by that time the sun be hot, ye shall have help. And the messengers came and showed it to the men of Jabesh, and they were glad. Therefore the men of Jabesh said, tomorrow we will come out unto you, and ye shall do with us all that seemeth good unto you. And it was so on the morrow that Saul put the people in three companies, and they came into the midst of the host of the morning watch. Okay, stop right there. So, okay, before we saw Saul, he was one that was cowering with fear. One that was very humble, but yet probably not in a good way. He would not take charge, but rather his servant took charge, or his father would take charge. Samuel took charge, and he didn't see himself as the king. But now, when he hears about Jabesh Gilead, the Spirit of God comes upon him, and he gets bold. He gets courageous. He takes initiative. He does a wonderful plan that everybody comes to, and now he tells 110,000 men to be in one company. That's 330,000 divided by 3. Yep, good at math. That's what I'm really good at. You know, in school, I was terrible at math. But God helped me through working at South Lake. That math is no longer an issue because I really actually enjoy it. It's very logical. Anyway, so 110,000 men on one side, another 110,000 men on the other side, and another 110,000 men on another side. So he arranged the people in the way they should be arranged. Think about the leadership capabilities that a person needs to have in order for that to happen. When we had a lot of kids in Kids Corner, I would find it hard for everybody to come and do the exact same thing. And there were only maybe 10, probably less. Not 110,000 or even more, 330,000. The leadership capabilities of Saul now has increased dramatically. So now he is empowered by God to do the task that God has called him to do. So, what happens? They go out, the rest of verse number 11, and slew the Ammonites until the heat of the day, and it came to pass that they which remained were scattered, so that two of them were not left together. They had a victory over the Ammonites, a group of tough individuals. We don't know how big a size their group was, but Saul, through his leadership abilities, did miraculously come to the aid of a town and save them. And they triumphed. They were crazy. It's amazing to see when somebody steps out by faith in order to do something. When God empowers a person to do a specific task, amazing things happen. What happens? People got saved. What happens? People got discipled. What happens? People start paying the price. Revival happens when people start doing what is right. And God empowers the person that he calls. And if you're a Christian today, each one of you, if we know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, God has called us to be, he called us to do something. We're his workmanship created unto Christ Jesus unto good works. So each one of us needs to seek God and just say yes to him and no to ourselves. We just need to say yes and submit to God's word and the leading and guiding of the Holy Spirit. And if we do that, we will be empowered just like Saul was, only more so. In the Old Testament time, the Spirit of God would come upon somebody, but that was in a permanent state. Eventually, we know the story of Saul, that he will lose the Holy Spirit and be given an evil spirit. For us, though, in our Christian era, the Holy Spirit will never leave us. It sealed us until the day of redemption. When is that? It's when we're in heaven. Jesus says, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Well, where is he at right now? He's in heaven. But he has given us his Spirit, his Holy Spirit, that indwells in our hearts and helping us, teaching us in the way that we should go. And so for tonight, the challenge is just to be and to do what God wants you to. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for Saul and what we learned from him. We see your hand upon him and miracles happen. May you help each one of us to get closer with you, to put you first in our lives, to adore you, to worship you. May we have our lives as a living sacrifice unto you. Please, Father, help us put away our things that so easily beset us, the sin in our life that we're holding on to. May we get rid of that today. Help us to be. Help us to do.